So hi, my name is Sebastian. I work for Simina, which is a small subsidiary of Teoco. And about half a year ago, I did an internal tech talk because I had developed this small utility, and I said, well, this would be a good opportunity to teach my coworkers about a little bit of template metaprogramming. And the reception, they thought it was good, and I thought, well, I should do this on a larger scale. So here I am. You can get the code for this at GitHub if you want to follow along. It's organized. You've got various version, incremental versions of the tool I'm building. And for each version CPP file, there's a snippets file which contains random code that I will be pasting into those files to complete them. If you want to follow along, you will need, for some of the examples, a very recent Clang. I don't think GCC supports fold expressions yet, so it actually has to be Clang. And you have to pass the std is C++1Z switch. All right. Nope, that was wrong. Where's my mouse? Here. Okay, let's load this. Nope. Yes, thank you. All right, so the tool I'm going to be developing is called switchAny, and it's basically a switch statement over types contained in a Boost.Any. So for those not familiar with Boost.Any, I'm going to do a short introduction. Boost.Any is a container for a single value of any type whatsoever, as long as that type is copyable. And it remembers what type you put in. You can get that type out again. It can be used, for example, to allow the user to store some of his own information within data structures of your library, as an example. So any is pretty simple to use. You have a variable of type any. You assign anything copyable to it and use any cast to get it out again. And you have to cast to the same type that you put in. If you cast to something different, well, it will tell you it can't cast. So there's two ways to find it out. Either you try to cast a pointer to any, in which case you get a pointer out, and it will be null. Or you try to cast to the value type or a reference, and it will throw. It will throw a bad any cast, which actually derives from std bad cast. So what you can do is you can ask the any, okay, so what type do you contain? And the type function gives you a reference to the type info object. And then you can ask its name, which may or may not be useful. An any is copyable, and it's a deep copy. So if you copy an any, the object contained within will be copied too. So if I then get a reference to the contained string, so I can any cast to a reference too, and change the value in there, well, this will print the new value, this will still print the old value. And let me compile and run this little program. That is the any introduction. So what we have here is, well, we put 42 in, we cast it to int, and it writes 42 out. It tells us yes, trying to cast to a long, which is looks the same, or depending on whether it's on your particular compiler, could actually be binary compatible with an int, but it's not the same type, so this fails. And so this pointer is actually a null pointer, so it wrote true. And here we see, well, yes, it threw the exception. When we try to anycast this any that contains an int to a bool, it throws an exception, saying boost bad anycast, failed conversion using boost anycast. This any contains a string, a slit string. I'm using the user-defined literal suffix for slit string. We could also just manually construct the slit string here. And it tells us, yes, the name of the type, well, this is the mangled name of the standard library string. And after the copy happened of that, if we cast the copy to string, write it out, you get hello, which shows that the string was correctly copied. And after the modification, writing out the first any prints by, and the second still contains hello. So any questions about Boost.Any? Okay. So here's the problem I faced. I had a situation where the user passed in an any, and that could contain lots of different types depending on some configuration the user passed earlier. And the particular problem that I had was, well, he passes in a string, then the any has to contain a slit string. Because if the any contains a string literal, then the type contained within the any is not slit string, it's const char star. So this will throw. So if I take this and I try to run it, and I call this function, well, the first print statement works. The first any contains a slit string, so this is correctly cast and printed. But the second one, it throws an exception, so I get an uncaught exception. It says, well, bad any cast, failed conversion using bad any cast, and it wraps it in the whole boost exception machinery. And I wanted a way to say, okay, this any could contain something string-like, just give me a slit string. So what I did was, at first I wrote this utility function called string from any that works with const char star and slit string, and actually also char star, which is a different type from const char star for the purposes of Boost.Any. And it basically contained this. So it had, well, if this Boost.Any contains a slit string, I'll then return that. If it contains a const char star, construct a string from that. If it contains a char star, construct a string from that. And this is ugly. So yes, this way works. So I can try this test program and say build and run the problem statement and call solution. My build and run script actually doesn't care whether I pass the .cpp or not. So and it says, yeah, yes one, yes two, yes three. It could get the string out of all three versions. Whether that is a slit string, whether that's a, well, that's a const char star, a slit string, or a char star. So this works, but, well, not exactly the way I wanted it. So,
sorry, what does decay do?
What does decay do? Decay was a small utility function that I defined at the front that just takes in a pointer and returns the pointer. Because you can't directly, if you try to assign the character array, the string literal or a local character array variable to the any, it doesn't work. You get a compile error. So the decay just forces the array of the string literal to decay to a pointer. Right, so how could we write string from any in a nice fashion, right? Because this, it's just this is if-else chain is just lots of boilerplate, and I wanted to avoid that because what I really want to write is this. I want to switch on that any and say, well, if it contains a slit string, well, give me that. If it contains a const char, give me that. And if it contains anything else, well, just return an empty string. I can deal with that. So this is basically pattern matching in functional languages. which we don't have in C++. And then I thought, well, how close can I get to this syntax? And actually can get pretty close. So this is the first thing I wanted to achieve. I wanted to say, okay, I have a function that I give the any, and then I give it a bunch of lambda functions that are tagged to say, well, if this contains a std string, call this lambda with the converted value, with the extracted value. So this lambda would actually already be passed the string. If it contains a const char star, call this lambda, and so on. If it contains anything else, call this lambda. This lambda doesn't have an argument because, well, what would the type be? So this was the basic, this is the first goal that we want to achieve, but here's the problem. At work we use Microsoft Visual Studio 2013 and it doesn't have generic lambda, so I can't actually write this. What I do have to write is this. So, well, std string here, std string there. This is a lot of boilerplate again. And so I thought, okay, I can do better than that because I only want to write the type once. And I can omit it here because I don't have generic lambdas. Maybe I can omit it here. So the second step that we want to achieve is doing that. We want to write it like this. We want to deduce the type that is supposed to be in the any from the lambdas argument. So that's going to be step two. And actually, we don't need these at all. We don't need to write type case. Why not just write this? And this is the final goal. So we're going to do this in several steps. We're going to write a test case, make it work, and then move on. All right. Questions? Yes?
Is the default required? Can't you like check if the lambda has no arguments?
So the question is the default required? The default is required because this works with a lambda that has no arguments directly passed, and it means an any that doesn't contain anything. A boost any can be empty. And without arguments, I take this, and then the default is required to say, okay, this is for all other cases.
No, I mean, do you have actually to specify the default underscore, or is there a way to detect that the lambda has no arguments and understand that that's the default case?
So is there a way to detect that the lambda has no arguments and use it as the default case? Yes, there is a way to detect that the lambda has no arguments, and I use it, but I use it to mean something different. I use it to mean an any that is default initialized,
yeah,
that is empty.
Yeah, you had that.
And you have to distinguish these two, the default case and the empty case. You have to distinguish them and said, well, I'm going to mark this as default. Yes?
The way to fix that, to get rid of that argument default, would be to pass the any itself to the default case, which can in some cases be useful.
So the comment is, I could say, well, the default case is a lambda that just takes an argument of type any, which I could do. Yes, that would be a way. David?
But wouldn't that work if any with an any in it?
I don't think that's possible.
Yeah. So the question is, what if you have an any that has an n in it? And that's not possible because if you try to initialize an any with an any, you'll call the copy constructor and not the injection constructor. There was another question around here?
That was probably me.
Okay. Good, moving on.
I was going to make a comment or a suggestion. Can you, in the default case, maybe pass in the type info, like a pointer to the type?
Could I pass in a type info in the default case? Well, I could do that, but then I have the ambiguity, because in any...
You still have it as default.
Oh.
Otherwise,
yeah, so I could pass in the type info to the default case to let them throw an exception and say, well, I can't handle this type in particular. That would work. It's an interesting idea. In my use case, I didn't need it, so I didn't do it. Okay. Let's go with the first version of this. So the fluff header just contains includes for Boost.Any, for Google tests, so nothing special there. So we write the first test case, and it says, well, let's do a switch.Any that just has a default and see if we can make that work. So this won't compile, of course, because it doesn't contain any useful code. So let's get some. Give me that mouse over here. So we need two functions here. We call switch.Any, and the first argument it gets is an any, and the second and any further arguments are cases. So we'll make that a variadic template, and we can also see we explicitly specify the result type, because there's no way, well, there might actually be a way to derive the result type from the result types of the lambdas.
There is standard common type.
Yes. So I could derive it. I didn't do that. I just said, well, I'm going to explicitly specify it. So here's the switch.Any function. And it's a variadic template. So it's got the any as the first argument and any number of cases after that. And we're just going to return 0. And to make it compile, we also need to have something that default case, a function default case. So let's make it very simple and say, well, you know, just return 0, ignore the lambda that is passed in, save it, run. So, well, it compiles, but of course the test fails because it returns 0 and not 1. So what do we have to do? Well, to make this work, we have to say, we have to capture this lambda in some way and then call it. So let's do that. Let's write a wrapper. Let's return some wrapper type from this. So let's make this look like this instead. And we need to write this class. And it's a very simple thing and not necessarily very well designed, but it will suffice for now. So we have a simple class called default case, and it stores the function that you pass in, and it gives you a way to get it out again. And then we just need to replace switch.Any with a version that, well, that tries the various cases out and basically takes the one that fits. So in this case, it's easiest to say, well, we're going to delegate to a helper function. So let's replace this one with a version that delegates. It's usually you want the interface function to be simple and then delegate to some implementation in the background. And the implementation is, well, the question is, how do we deal with a variadic template argument pack that we have here? And one of the typical things you do is you write a sort of recursive function that picks up the first part of that pack, does something with it, and then calls itself with the rest of the arguments. And then you have the base case version that acts on, well, an empty pack or maybe a pack containing one element. So the empty version in our case is going to say, well, if we don't have any cases, then something went wrong. The user wrote a switch that doesn't cover all the possible cases, right? So we have a switch.Any impl that has no arguments, which is going to be called if cases is empty. And then we just say assert, fail, die, something went wrong. You didn't write a default case. You didn't write a case for every type that could possibly be in that any. So this is not very interesting. We got the actual thing that does something. And we're going to keep it simple because we only need to make that one test case work. So We're going to just say, well, if we have one case here and an arbitrary number of other cases that may be empty, well, we're just going to take that case, say, give us a function, and we'll call it. Let's try that. It works. So we now took that lambda and called it. And it returned 1, and we returned that back to the caller of switchAny. OK. Let's look at the second version. So this is basically the same code we just wrote, without the comments, and with a new test case. Now, namely, we want to say, well, if we have an empty any, we don't want to call the default case. We want to call that empty case. Well, this is actually pretty easy to make that test case work, because we can totally cheat. So we're going to cheat. We're going to say, well, the cases are tried in order. And so if I just call this one unconditionally, this test case will work. We just need an empty case function. And because we're going to cheat, it's just going to return a default case object and just say, well, great. That's test-driven development. So to prevent us from cheating, we need a better test. Yeah, question?
Don't you mean to write V2?
I mean to write V2. You're absolutely right. All right. Let's make a test that is not as easy to cheat on. V3 contains a test where, yeah, well, now if we try to run this, this will not work, because it's going to choose that empty case, but the any is not empty. So it should actually use the default case. And we can see that it fails by running V3. And it says, well, it expected to return to have 1, and it actually returned 2, which is what the empty case returns. So let's make that work. What do we need for that? Well, we need a different class from the default case to hold the new function. And we need to tell it to ask every case whether it actually supports this any. So this looks like this. We make a new class. Let's call it empty case. And it currently looks exactly like default case. And then we adjust the function empty case to return the new class. And now, well, we have to give each class a function that says, well, do you actually support do you want this type, is the question. And the default case is simple, because we say, well, the default case wants any type. No matter what comes in, we say, yeah, we want that. And the other option is the empty case, which says, well, we want an any that's empty. So if an any is empty, then its type function returns the type info for void. So we just say, is the type info that we get the type ID of void? And now we just switch any ample and say, well, we no longer want to call the function unconditionally. We just want to call it if it actually supports our type. And this looks like this. So if the current case supports the type, we call the function. And otherwise, we try the rest of the cases. And this doesn't compile. Why doesn't it compile? Did I forget anything? Yeah, of course I forgot anything. So, by the way, error messages when you template metaprogramming. So this is actually the same single message repeated three times for every test case, and it basically says, well, I can't call switchAny input because I just changed switchAny input that it wants a type. It wants the type info so that it can switch on it. If we look at this, well, we now have a type info argument here. So let's adjust the other functions to also match that. So we take the empty case. And now takes in the type info. And the main switch any function needs to get the type out of the any and pass it to the input function. And the reason we do that once instead of, you know, in every function, because it's a virtual function call and it's just a small performance optimization that we only retrieve the type once and pass it along. All right, this should work. Great. Now let's do, yeah, question.
Is there any reason you can't get the boost.any as a const reference?
Well, yes, if it's a const reference, then the thing I get out, the type I get out is also a const reference, so I actually have to write both versions and we'll get to that. So the question was, is there a reason why I take the any by non-const reference and not by const reference? And strictly speaking, I should take it by universal reference and forward. I don't do that. Okay. So our next case is we want to support a version with we want to support the type case. So we want to say, well, if it contains an int, call this one. We put an int into the any, so we expect this version to be called. Now, what do we need for that? Well, we need a new case class, and we need a new function for that. We call it type case. Let's grab that and put it in here. All right, and the type case class with its own supports function. And the supports function of type case, of course, just says, well, I support the type if it's exactly the same as the one I'm templatized on. Will this work? That's the question. If I try this, what happens? Version 4. It fails to compile. What happened? Well, it says no matching function for call to object of type lambda. And it says, well, here we call something and it doesn't work. And in general, when you have a template metaprogramming error, there are two relevant bits of detail. And the first relevant part is the error at the very top, and the second one is at the very bottom, because it says, because that's where it tells you where your code is. Everything in between is just other template code. Usually you don't need most of the stack, you just need the bottom. And it here it also gives us additional information, because it says, well, it tried to call this lambda without any arguments, but this lambda wants one argument. So the whole get function thing we did isn't working anymore. Because in this function here, we say, well, give me the function and then I'm going to call it without any arguments. But the type cases need arguments. So let's change that. Instead of getting the function, let's do something that is actually just better object-oriented design. We're not going to get the function out and call it. We're just going to tell the case object, well, call your function. And you know the right way to do it. So we take the new snippet and say, well, we're going to replace the get function with a function called call. And this just says, well, I'm going to call the lambda. And in the default case, the lambda doesn't want any arguments, so we're just going to ignore the any that's been passed to us. And the return type is whatever the lambda returns. And we use return type deduction to not specify it ourselves. Unless, of course, we're using Visual Studio 2013 or an older GCC or really any older compiler which doesn't have that. In which case, well, you can use std result of. You can just take this auto and replace it with this. Well, if you, or a result of without the underscore t suffix, then you have to write type name std result of that call and then add a colon colon type at the end. And this works as well. But if you have a compiler that's new enough, this is just nicer. And then we need another one of these, because for the default, for the empty case, it looks the same. Here too, we have the lambda that doesn't take any arguments. And the typed case, well, that one wants to pass the any, but cast to the right type. So we're going to do this. And we're actually, I'm using here as a performance optimization, I'm using unsafe anycast, which is not actually a documented part of any's API. So, but it basically is the same as anycast, except it doesn't do the type check. It's kind of like static casting a void pointer to whatever type you want. And since I already have my own type check before that, I said, well, that's safe for me. And I'm going to do that and avoid the additional.
Does it actually make any difference that you can measure, given that you're already doing a whole bunch of type info comparisons?
So the question is, does it actually make a performance difference and measure it? But I don't know. I haven't measured. I just said, well, it's six more letters, and I'm just going to type it and not worry about it, because I know it's safe. And the only problem is, if I ever upgrade to a boost version where unsafe anycast is gone, then I have to change it back. And well, at our company, we don't upgrade Boost very often. So, and we use again the return type deduction. And if we didn't do that, well, we'd have to use result of again. So, yeah. And then, oops.
Couldn't you just use T?
Could I just use T? No, because T is the argument type of the lambda, not necessarily the return type. So now we just need to change the switch any impl function to not use get function, but instead call the call function. And this looks like this. So we call the call member. We pass the any. And now this should work.
You have an extra brace.
No. No, that's the namespace detail brace that it just put up there. So yeah, it works. Great. We've almost reached our first goal. Of course, this doesn't quite work. So let's look at the way it doesn't work. One of the ways it doesn't work is that thing you mentioned earlier. What if I have a const any and I pass it? It's not going to compile. So let's fix that. Here it says, well, it can't call switch any because that expects a non-const reference and I'm passing a const. So what are we going to do? Well, let's just add a new version of switchAny that takes a const reference. Oh, wrong. And now we could make switchAny a template on the type of the any, but it's kind of complicated to say, well, it should take a boost any kind of boost any. Should it be a const reference or a non-const reference or an R value reference? And yes, you can do that, but it's complicated and leads to pretty bad error messages. So I'm just going to say, well, here on the outside, on the interface that the user uses, I'm just write these out explicitly. But the implementation, we can template this so that we don't have to duplicate the entire implementation as well. So I'm going to take the impl functions and turn them into templates, template in the type of any coming in. So now I have a new template parameter called any, and I take an any reference, and the compiler can actually deduce that if I pass in a const any reference to say, well, any is const boost any. And we'll do the same thing for the other version. My mouse is here. Great, and we also need to adjust the signature of the call members of our case classes. This and this and this. All right. It works. So we avoided the duplication of the entire implementation, but we still have the error message at the front if I pass in something that is not an any. So that's a good thing. Of course, we don't actually get an error message because the compiler will just initialize a temporary any and pass that to the const reference overload. But all right, what's the second thing that we are still cheating on? It's this one. What happens if I do this? Because remember, these cases are tried in order. So it's going to say, well, empty, no, that any isn't empty. But default case says, yeah, well, I'll take that. Give it to me. I'm done. And we'll never reach this type case. And this is different from how a standard C++ switch works. So that's undesirable. We don't want to force the user to always write the default case at the end or else get weird behavior. So what can we do about this? Well, here's what we're going to do. Oh, by the way, let me just run this test, show that it fails. It does, because it returns 1 instead of 3. Here's what we can do about it. Well, we can say, let the default case support nothing instead of everything. And then, in our cases, pick it out separately. And if we don't find any other case, then we'll specifically call the default case. So how would that work? Well, first, as I said, let's tell the default case to support nothing. And it's pretty easy, because we just say up here, well, return false. And now we're going to skip over it if you find it in the list of cases. And the other thing what we want to do is more complicated. We want to say, well, let's find that default case. And if nothing else wants to call it, well, then no other case wants to handle the any, well, we call the default case. And this is a small change in the interface function, which is duplicated across the two overloads. So we just say, well, we're going to pass an additional argument to the switch any impl, and it's going to be the default case. So we're going to write a function that takes all these cases and says, well, where's the default? Yes?
Would it be a lot simpler to just write an overload that looks, detects it and then ships it to the end?
Would it be a lot easier to write an overload that detects and shifts it to the end? Yes. It would be a lot less instructive. Because then I wouldn't get to write the big default function. But yes, it would probably be simpler. So We need to change the switch any input functions. The one that has no other case left is no longer going to assert. It's now going to call the default that we passed in. Right? That's one version. And the other version is unchanged, except that it now takes in a default and passes it through the call chain. So like this. It hasn't really changed. It just now takes in a default and it passes it on. So we need to implement the pick default. Well, how does that work? We write another recursive function that just takes apart the cases, right? And it says, well, if the first thing is some case, well, I'm just going to skip that and keep searching. And I'm again using return type deduction. If I don't have that, I can use a trailing return type and decal type. So that would look like this. I just take this decal type and attach it. And the problem with that, of course, is that the expression is repeated here. So it's prettier without. And the other case, that the second case that is interesting is, well, we actually find a default case. So, yeah, let's return that. We're done with our search. And if you're not doing this from scratch, if you're using a metaprogramming library, this is basically a find algorithm, with the criteria being, well, this should be an instantiation of default case. So I'm not using any metaprogramming library here. So if you have one, that's probably nicer to write it that way. But this is about the basic technique. And finally, there's the question, OK, what happens if we don't find any default case? The user just didn't write one. Well, we still need to handle that, or we'll get a compile error that's saying, well, I can't call pick default without any arguments. So let's add that. And this one is going to return a default case with the function that it's going to call being something that we'll write, a no default struct, which contains pretty much what our final version of switchAny contained, namely the assertion that, well, something went wrong, you didn't write a default case. So let's try that. This works. Question?
Just curious, how would you test for the lack of a default?
What do you mean? How would I test?
Like it just as a sort of detail. If it terminates the program, then how do you test that?
Well, so the question is, how do I test for a default, for the lack of a default? Well, it's going to try all the cases. So it's going to recursively say I have a test case here, right? I have a test case that doesn't have a default. Well, I don't have a test case yet that doesn't have a default. But let's say I had one. Then the cases argument tuple would contain a lot of cases, but none of them would be a default case instantiation. So the pick default function would, you know, always use this version. It would never use this version. So it would never return D. It would always use this version, picking off one case after the other until there are none left. And then it would call this version. So it returns this custom constructed.
Like. It was maybe more of an esoteric question. So how do you actually test it in your unit test framework?
Oh. How do I test that in a unit test framework? So you could write a Google death Google test supports something called death tests, which is basically, I assert that this particular expression will crash. You could use that.
Would it be nice to have a warning there as well, if it sticks
there? A compiler warning. So the question is, would it be nice to have a compiler warning or even a compiler error? I could actually emit a compiler error in this case. Well, yes, if you like, if for a normal switch you want the compiler to error out or warn you if you don't have a default case. And I don't like that warning. So, and the compiler case for a built-in switch is a matter of a compiler switch to enable or disable this warning. And in this case, you could do a preprocessor defined to say, well, this should be an error, this should be a warning. Of course, generating compiler warnings is tricky because there is no standard facility for that. And there's just pragma warning in some compilers, and I can't do that template instantiation dependent. So Boost has some, I think Boost has a facility to emit a compiler warning that is per compiler, does some weird thing to, but it's not pretty.
And it doesn't always work.
And it doesn't always work.
Compiler comes out.
Yeah, so you get a new compiler version and nobody updates the Boost macro, then you don't get the warning. Or it uses the wrong version of the macro and then you actually get a compiler error. So it's not very reliable either, so yeah. I chose not to do a warning, I just crash at runtime. Okay, so this works. And this means we're actually done with our first goal, right? Because we can now write a series of typed cases and say, well, no matter what order they're in, it's going to pick the right one. If you duplicate them, then it won't pick the latter any time and it will not warn you about this. You could actually write additional code that generates errors if you duplicate a type case or have two empty cases or have two default cases. I chose not to do that. It's an exercise for the reader. Any questions about this before we move on? Okay. Let's get to the next version. Next version, we want to say, oh, we don't want to say that yet. Want to say, well, first we want to say, well, if you don't pass an explicit result to switchAny, it's going to default to void. And if the result is void, you don't need a default case. It's okay to just go through this and do nothing. So currently, this one will crash because it says, well, I didn't pick any default case. Boom. So this is the first thing that it says. Well, switchAny, you need to explicitly specify the result. So let's remove that need. And that's pretty easy. Well, but just say the switchAny. Where are we? Oh, wrong file. Result defaults to void. Do it for this case as well. Okay, what is it doing now? Well, it's giving us a really long error. Let's get that out on its own. So what happened here? Well, as I said before, the important parts are always the top. It says, well, I can't call a no default void with no arguments. And it says, well, here's a candidate function, the operator, the call operator of no default. Well, but it wants an argument. Why does it want an argument? Basically because it's screwed up. Because this no default here shouldn't take an argument. Because this is a function that you pass to default case And the function that you pass the default case shouldn't take any arguments. All the lambdas that we passed didn't take any arguments. So if we remove that, well, now it compiles and crashes, as I said. So, but the lesson here is, you know, all this stuff in between didn't matter. And mostly when you encounter a weird template error, look at the very top and the very bottom. And only if the top says, well, this is the SDL internal, let me go through the backtrace until I find code that I wrote, because this is where you screwed up, usually, unless the library contains an error. But let's hope that's not the case, usually. OK, what can we do about this? Well, we can just say, well, no default for a void result shouldn't crash. And we can do that with template specialization. Just say, this struct, let's specialize it. If the result is void, then the call operator does nothing. That's OK. And this is a simple case of full template specialization and completely overriding the behavior. Now it passes the test, it doesn't crash, and we're really done. I promise. All right, let's move on to this version, where I can just say type case underscore, and it's going to take the lambda and say, well, the first argument is something like an int, in this case an int reference, so I want to accept anys that contain ints. How do we do that? Well,
you're going to do both the explicit case and now the sort of deduced case.
I'm going to do both the explicit case and the deduced case, yeah. The switch any will support both at the same time. And the nice thing is we basically have everything we need is already in place. We just need to, you know, this type case underscore function just needs to find out, well, what's the argument of the lambda I'm being passed? And let's instantiate and then basically do the same thing as this one. Right? So if we just introduce a new function that can do that, then I'm already done. So what I really need is this. I need to find out, well, given a function, what is its argument? And this is not a thing that is generally solvable in C++, but in the special case we're dealing with, you can solve it. There is a standards proposal for making function traits that would basically allow you to inspect the function, let it test, ask it, okay, how many arguments do you support and what are the types? But we just assume, well, this function supports one argument and we want to know what its type is. So, detail deduced type, what does it look like? Deduced argument. Well, let's go into the detail namespace and put this in. Well, so I'm going to do this in several steps. First, I'm saying, give me the first argument of that function, but that's going to be int ref, because the lambda I put down there takes an int ref. And I don't want int ref, because a boost any never contains an int ref. It contains an int. So I'm just going to use the std dk trait and pass that on. So first argument. And I usually follow this convention. So the standard has all these underscore t aliases that just remove the necessity to write type name, trait, colon, colon, type. And I usually go the other way around. I give my alias the plain name and then choose the impl suffix for the version that has type name, colon, colon, type. So first argument for me looks like this. Not very exciting, is it? So the real magic happens, of course, in first argument info. And this is going to be has lots of partial specializations. But we have a base case. Because what do we say? OK, well, what could this fn thing be, right? It could be a function. It could be a member function. Or it could be a callable object. And if it's a callable object, that means it has a member function called operator open close parents. And we can ask that thing what its actually first argument is. So that's exactly what we're doing here. We say, well, in the base case, if none of the other specializations that I'm about to add work, well, then I'm going to say, give me the address of your operator, of your call operator. Give me the type of that and pass it back to first argument info. And this is a recursive, and this would be an endless recursion unless, of course, I add specialization. So I'm going to do that next. And of course, taking the address of a member function only works if that function is neither a template nor overloaded, which is why if you pass this a generic lambda, where the call operator is a template, this is going to say, well, I don't know which operator parent-parent you mean. And it's probably going to give you a long stack backtrace below that to confuse you. But at the top, it would say, I don't know which one you mean. So what other thing could fn be? Well, fn could be a function type or a pointer to function. So let's specialize first argument info for this case. And this is a partial specialization, not a full specialization, because it still has template arguments. So I say, well, if fn is of the form, well, it has a result type, it's a pointer to a function, and its argument types, it has at least one argument, and then some other arguments that I don't care about. Then I say, well, my first argument type is this first argument. And this pack, of course, can again be empty. So this works for a one argument function. And well, there is a bunch of other cases that we can deal here. Namely these. This is a raw function type. I don't think this will actually ever occur, but I wrote it just to be safe. And it could be a pointer to a member function. So we have the type fn is of the form, well, it has a result type. It's a pointer to a member of some class C. It has one argument that's arg and maybe some other arguments. And the type we're looking for is arg. And then I have to repeat that for const member functions because their type looks different. Do I have to match it for volatile as well? Yes, if I ever wrote a volatile member function, which I have never done in my life. Would I have to do it for reference qualified member functions? I actually don't know because...
Yes.
Okay, the answer from back there is yes. But remember, I wrote this for MSVCU 2013, which doesn't have reference qualifiers, so no. All right. So you probably need a lot of copy and paste of this one for all the possible versions. Any other questions? OK, let's see if that works. This is V8. No, it doesn't. Why not? No member named deduced argument in namespace detail. I think I forgot to save the file. Yeah, that was it. All right. We're done. We've achieved our second goal. We can now write the version where we just deduce the type. So we're going to move on. We're actually going to move a step back because I forgot one thing that I wanted to show. And that's an alternative way to implement the whole decide which case I take way. And because right before I wrote a recursive function that picked off a case every time, tried it out, and then selected if that matched. And another version to do that would be, well, let's build a map from the types that our cases want to the functions that are supposed to be called, and then do a lookup in that map. Yeah,
Stephen. So, just can you go back to the slider?
Back to this one, yeah.
So, for first argument, you're returning the first argument of the member function rather than the class type. If you actually pass the member function in explicitly, rather than doing it through this recursion,
yeah.
Is that what you would, that would probably not be what you wanted. Because this only works when you're getting into there from the recursion from the original base, the original
yes.
main specialization.
So the comment is, there's really no good reason why these are specialization of first argument implementation. They should be the same. So this should be actually be a separate struct that is first argument of member pointer. And I didn't do that because I was lazy, and sometimes you write ugly code. Yeah, it's a very good comment. And I actually thought of changing it that way, but just didn't. True. So I want to show this other way of doing it, not because it's a good way of doing it, but because it shows another interesting template metaprogramming technique. So the idea is, well, in the switchAny impl, I'm no longer going to recurse. I only have one version of this. And I'm going to say, well, I make a map from type index to some std function. And I'm going to register all my cases. I tell every case, well, put yourself into that map. And then I'm going to make a lookup in that map. And if I don't find anything, I'm going to call the default case that I picked out as I did previously. And otherwise, I'm going to call that function that is in the map. And what I did here was, well, I changed these, like, instead of the call function, now they have a register in function, and the default case does nothing because it doesn't want to register itself in the map. The empty case registers itself for the void type. And what the function just does is, well, it's going to call that function. It's called whatever the user specified. And for the type case, it's pretty much the same. So the interesting part here is, well, this. This is a fold expression that says, well, I have a parameter pack, and I basically want to repeat this expression for every member of that pack. So this will expand to first case register in case lookup, comma, second case register in case lookup, and so on. So this is a feature that's planned for C++ 17. It's not in C++ 14. So if you don't have fold expressions yet, you have to do that other thing. Where you create an array, and that array is initialized with an initializer list. Because an initializer list is a context in which even in C++ 11 you can do expansion of parameter packs. And so it's going to say, well, I'm going to expand this expression for every member of the cases pack. And you have this register in returns void, so you can't put that into an array, so you make it a comma expression and say, well, the actual value of that expression is 0. And it's horrible, and I would recommend if you have to do that, you wrap it up in a macro that does that for you. Yeah, I just wanted to show that. And this is not a good way to do it, because now on every switchAny call, you first build a map, and then you do a lookup in the map, and then you call through the std function indirection. Question, yeah? Why do you need the first zero? Because the question is, why do I need the first zero here? this error up there. The reason is, if there are no cases in general, so this is an expansion of the generic macro I use for all cases. So for switch any, you wouldn't pass no cases. But in other cases, it may be that you have an empty pack. And if an empty pack, this expands to nothing. And then you would say, well, I have an array, and I want to initialize it with an empty initializer list. The compiler is going to say, well, you can't have an empty array. An array cannot have zero length. So I always add a first element, so the array has at least one length. And yeah, question back there?
OK, just a comment on the trick of expanding it before all the expressions.
Yeah.
I usually do it by having a type
mm-hmm.
that has a templated constructor
mm-hmm.
that takes basically anything
mm-hmm.
and does nothing with that.
Mm-hmm.
And that way, instead of doing, instead of abusing comma operator or having to put that additional zero at the beginning, I can just write, I call it swallow. So I just write swallow, brace, the expression ellipsis brace and
mm-hmm.
it just works.
Okay.
I think it's slightly nicer than using integer arrays.
Yeah. So the comment is instead of doing an integer array, you could also write a type that has a constructor that takes variadic arguments, any number of arguments of any type. And Stephen is shaking his head.
It's not going to work here because it returns void.
Because what?
Because it returns void. Oh, we still need the comment.
So, yeah, so that works. That works usually, but not if the thing returns void.
I didn't say it doesn't work with void.
Yeah.
So I usually, from functions that are meant to be used in that way, I return an instance of another empty type. Yeah.
So it
adds some little ugliness to the definition of the function, but it's way better at the expansion.
So the comment is, well, if the function returns void, you can change the function to return some empty struct, which increases the ugliness for the function, but makes this trick prettier. And I think this way is better because I hide this trick in a macro. It just says utility expand expression that contains a pack, and I don't care about how ugly that is, what it expands to. But I do care about how ugly the function is that I call in the expression, because that's actually code I write somewhere else. You were first, I think.
Is it also the case that initializer list, the order of expansion is defined, but with the function call it's not?
The question is it the case that with a function call, the order of execution of the sub-expressions is not defined, with an initializer list it is? That's true. In the case of his trick, it doesn't matter because he uses initializer list syntax to call the constructor, so you still have the defined execution order. Another question back there? Okay, same question. Okay. So, but, well, as I said, this is a horrible idea because, you know, the other thing is just a linear scan over the cases. And this, first, it builds a map, n log n, and it allocates memory, and then it does a O log n lookup, and then it does the interaction with hosted function, which means the compiler can't inline, which in the other version it can. So, you're not going to get rid of that indirection, by the way, so you don't get inlining, so don't do that. It was just an example. All right, let's move on. We were done with this one, I think. Yes. So the next thing we want to achieve is, well, I want to use the lambda without wrapping it. And I'm going to do it first for the empty case, and then I'm going to do it for the typed case. And the other thing I did was, well, I replaced default case with just default underscore, because once these long identifiers are gone, I want a short identifier here, because it looks prettier. No particular reason. It's also not very complicated, because I just add a function default underscore, which does exactly the same thing as the default case function. These two, as you can see, are identical except for the name. So, what do we have to do to make this work? Well, The problem is that our dispatch machinery still wants cases. So if we just give it a lambda, then we need to wrap that up in a case. So the point to act on is here. Well, currently we're passing switch any input gets a lot of gets the cases or the lambdas that we now get directly, and we can just say, well, I want to wrap all of these. Let's just say I'm gonna call a new function called scase on each of these. In functional terms, this is just a map, a transform of the cases tuple into a different cases tuple. And we want to make sure that after this transform, there are no raw lambdas left, but we instead have deduced, well, this is an empty case, this is a typed case. And if it's already a case object, we just pass it through. Okay? So the scase function, oh yeah, that should be detail scase, and of course, detail, nope. Every time I'm at work, I get used to an English keyboard, German keyboard, and when I use the laptop, I need to get used to the English one again. So, we're gonna write three overloads of this that work for existing case objects, so that any code we have so far would continue to work, right? So we have this S case. If you give it the S case some instantiation of type case, return it unchanged. Same thing for empty case and default case. All the old test cases now continue to work as usual. All we have introduced is one additional copy that the compiler might even elide. And the special thing what we need is, well, we need to say, well, if this is a lambda, particularly if it's a lambda that can be called with no arguments, then we want instead return an empty case. So, let's write a special version of scase for that. It looks like this. So what does this do? Well, it says, here's an overload. It can take any argument. So it might swallow those up above. It wouldn't take a default case or an empty case object as an argument, because those are more specialized. So when the compiler does overload resolution, when there are templates involved, there is this notion of more specialized than other things. And a plain C, this could take anything. This is less specialized than this default case of fn, which can just take various instantiations of default case. So we're good so far. But what we also want to do is later, we're going to say, well, if I pass in a lambda with one argument, that should not apply. So we need to say, well, we only want something that is callable with no arguments. So we say, well, I want this C to be callable without arguments. But there is no standard trait for that, so we need to write it. And if that is given, then we return an empty case. And what we use here is enable if. Standard enable if is a facility that allows you to further control operator overloading through switchAny. Is anyone here who hasn't heard of switchAny? Should I explain that? Okay, I guess not. What was that?
I said only at C++ now and nobody raised their hand.
Yeah, true. Only at C++ now would nobody raise a hand to that question. So we need to implement this callable, right? Well. So this is going to be a struct with one argument. So it's going to be a a class template, and it's got one argument, and that argument is the call, and we're just going to say this is false. We could actually static assert here. We could just say, well, you can't use it that way, because this version should never, ever be used. Because what we're now going to do is, again, we're going to specialize in various interesting forms of the type. We're going to say, well, let's specialize for something, some type where if n has the form some function with some arguments. Could be none, could be any number. And we're going to say, well, we're going to derive from whatever this function call returns. And this function call, the isCallable helper, that's an overloaded function. So we're going to say we have two overloads of this. One is the version that we use if something goes wrong. So if this isn't what we're looking for, it's got these two arguments because we're passing the arguments explicitly, so it's got to have these arguments. And then it can take absolutely everything as its argument. So we pass 0 here. It's going to accept that. It's going to return false type. So if this overload is chosen, then we're going to derive from false type. And false type has a static const bool member called value, which in the enable if below we're accessing, like here. So if we do it like this, nothing is ever callable. So we need that case where we say, OK, it should be callable. And this is a different overload. And it has the same template parameters. But it looks slightly different in its argument. And this is extended, or expressions fine. This is new. And this says, basically, well, I'm going to take one argument, and it's a pointer to this. This, actually. So this expression is long enough that my arms just barely are wide enough to put it, point it out. And it's going to be the type of, well, take some object of type fn and call it, some object and apply and call it with these arguments. Decal value, just give it any type, and it's going to give you back a value of the type. And it doesn't actually have an implementation because you can't just generically create something. Matt? This will break in some cases if it returns a reference. If the function returns a reference, you mean?
Because then we'd be forming a pointer to a reference.
Good point. Sfine would pick it up and throw it out and say, well, you can't call that, which is wrong. But yeah, so you probably should add a stdk around the decal type to make it work. And this is basically, well, let's say we have an fn and call it with args dot dot dot, if we actually had objects. We don't have objects, so we use decalval. And the compiler is saying, well, wait, what's the type of that argument? And it's going to say, well, OK, let's try call that fn with these arguments. And it's, well, if that works, it has a result type. It could be void, it could be int, it could be whatever. And it's going to say, well, OK, so you want the pointer to void argument. And it's going to say, well, I can take that 0 and convert it to that pointer, so that works. And it's better than this dot, dot, dot version, because everything is better than the dot, dot, dot version. So it's going to say, OK, we use this one and returns true type. So that value static const bool is true. And enable if says, great, you passed me true. I'm going to let this pass. But if this thing is not callable with these arguments, maybe it doesn't even have a call operator, or it has a call operator that takes a different number of arguments or different types, then compilers then say, well, that's not a valid expression. So expressions fine says, OK, then in that case, forget that overload exists. It's just going to see this one and says, well, if I have to, I'm going to call this one. And here's the funny thing. MSVC 2013 does not officially support expressions fine.
but this happens to work, so yay me. Without this, I don't think you could write an is-callable trait. All right, great. So I'm a little short on time, so this works for the empty case. Awesome. Let's make it work for the non-empty case. So we now have two lambdas, one without arguments and one taking an int ref. And since the any is now again full, we expect that the 3 is returned. So in the final version, we say, OK, up here we got this case where we say, well, if it is, if this is a callable with no arguments, then we use an empty case, and we can say, well, if it's not callable with no arguments in all other cases, we want a typed case. So let's add an overload for this. And put it here. Looks good. Let's try it. No, it does not look good. It actually says too many errors emitted to keep processing, and yeah, so it's apparently very bad. It's a wall of text full of errors. And what does it say? Well, it says, I don't have a call operator in default case. And that's true. And it says, well, I tried to instantiate first argument impl for a default case and tried to pick out its call operator. But why did it do that? How did we get here? So this is where the template backtrace gets interesting. It says, well, yeah, we're trying to instantiate first argument impl, we're trying to instantiate deduced argument, and we're doing it in line 153. So where is that? Well, that's here. Wait, but we have an enable if here that says, well, don't do that. Well, we said do that if it's not callable, but we have all these other overloads down there. Why didn't it use these ones? So Sphene has limits, right? Sphene just says, well, if there is an error here in this thing, then throw away the overload. But if some template instantiation further down has an error, The standard basically said, well, we can't expect compilers to roll back from any state where it's deep in some template instantiation, so the compiler is allowed to fail. And it says, well, I'm going to try to instantiate this signature for whatever, while I do overload resolution. So it says, well, OK, this default case, S case down there, well, that would work well. This one doesn't work. This one doesn't work. What about this one? And it says, OK, I'm half of this enable if t, and it's going to be some value here. And the result type would be type case with this deduced argument of c. And what is deduced argument of c? It tries to instantiate that. And it runs into this error while it tries to instantiate deduced argument deep in the template instantiation. And it says, well, OK, I can't sphene out of this. Sorry, error. Forget it. And the reason why we get so many errors is that we get it on every switchAny call in all the test cases. So we need to be smarter about this. And like, when I saw this error, I said, OK, what's the first smarter thing? Well, let's fix this vague condition. Let's say, well, instead of saying, well, we want it for everything that isn't callable with no arguments, let's fix it on things that are just callable with one argument. And our trait can actually handle that if we just define a little helper. And the little helper Actually, let's show the simple way of doing this first. The simple way, if you have deduced argument types, is doing this. We use a different way of using enableif, and we say, well, if it's not callable, do it in a default, and this is already going to fix this. So, because now it says, well, just deduce the argument, the result type, only if you actually chose that overload. As long as it's just doing overload resolution, it's saying, well, I don't care what it says in this body, and the deduced argument is gone from here. So this works if you have deduced, if you have return type deduction. So I can use this. I can save this. I can compile it. It runs. We're done. Except I still have to make it work on compilers without return type deduction. So let's go back to that version. What can I do here? I can say, well, let's try to be smarter about this and say, well, let's use a little helper and say, if I can call this C, if it's callable with any argument, I don't care what argument, as long as it is one argument. Well, I define a struct any arc. And any arc says I can convert to any type whatsoever, whether it's an L value or an R value, I can convert to this. Don't ask me to actually do it because I don't have implementations for these conversion operators, but I totally can do it, I promise. And so we can say, well, if C is callable within any arc, then it says, well, okay, whatever the one argument of C is, if I can call it with that, that's great. And this is how you can make isCallable ask, okay, can I call it with any one argument? Is this an unary function? And this still doesn't work because, sure, we're now smarter, but it will still try to instantiate this. It will still try to do it and it will still fail. So if I try to compile this again, we're back to this one. So how can we be even smarter? Well, there's a little facility in the Boost MPL. It's called a lazy enable if. The idea is, well, since this keeps failing to compile, we want to hide this. And we want to say, well, this enable if is eager in its result type. It tries to find out what its result is immediately, even if the condition actually fails. A lazy enable if doesn't. A lazy enable if says, well, give me as the result type, not the actual result type, but something that if the condition is true, I'll look inside and say, well, now give me the result type. And since the standard doesn't contain a lazy enable if, we're going to write our own. It's a pretty simple thing. It looks like this. So this is roughly what enable if looks like too, right? You've got a struct. It has a boolean and a type name, a result type name, and it's got the base version doesn't contain anything. And then when you try to access it and that's a type, you get a Sfina error. But it has a specialization if the condition is true, and then the type is the result type. And the difference in the lazy result is just that instead of writing type is the result, we type is type name lazy result colon colon type. And now we add a lazy wrapper around this deduced argument. Right? This thing that causes the problem down here. This thing, we want to hide it. So we make a wrapper. This just hides this computation. And if we now replace this version with this one, then it works. It compiles and we're done. So Here's the funny thing. Lazy enable if isn't really necessary because, well, I could just as well write the code like this. I could use a standard enable if and then look into that. So we've got this enable if t, and then I say, okay, and whatever this returns, I then want to look at its colon colon type. And then I don't need the whole lazy enable if thing. Except that MSVC 2013 has a bug where this completely fails to compile always. I don't know why, so I had to write the lazy enable if. Yeah. So, but this one works on Clang as well. So I've got three different versions that work in Clang. I've got just one that works in MSVC. And I've got the final version. This is the version that uses all the C++ 14 goodness that Clang supports. And that's it. Questions? Go ahead.
Can you go back to that callable AER?
Sure. Up or down?
As case function. Yeah, this one.
This is
so
the.
My understanding that the type of C is going to be some kind of callable object.
Yes. Yeah.
So what is the type of C empty brackets? Is
the type of. Yeah, it's the question is what is the type of. What is this type, right? So it's the same trick that std result of uses. So technically speaking, this is the type of a function that returns a C and takes no arguments. But it kind of looks like a call to a C, and this is why this syntax is abused to mean, well, this means call an object of type C with no arguments. And because all I need to do on this is pattern match, right? All is callable do is pattern match on this. Here is callable. This is the C open close parents, and it just pattern matches and says, well, the C is the FN and the args is the nothing within the parentheses. It doesn't care that it's really the return type. David.
So first off, thanks for doing this. I think you covered, it's amazing how much stuff you covered with just this one example.
Thank you.
How much of this do you think would be simplified had you had available a template metaprogramming library to use?
Question is, how much would it have been simplified if I had a template metaprogramming library? So I think things that would have been simplified would be the pick default would be more readable, the S case down here would probably be implementable as a map or transform. So in the end, I think the code wouldn't be much shorter, but it would be more explicit. Like a standard algorithm can be more explicit than a for loop and more clearly convey intent without actually being shorter. I think the code would be more readable, but not necessarily shorter, because this is a very simple. Of course, I've done more complicated metaprogramming that really benefited from having a good metaprogramming library.
Basically, comment about this question.
Okay.
It's funny because during this session, I actually implemented something similar to this, and I got like 87 lines. I think it could be simplified a lot. That's just my opinion.
So let me just check. So without the test cases, my thing is about 220 lines long. So the comment was, well, Louis probably used Boost.Any to implement this using a metaprogramming library, and he said, well, he got about 50 lines of code?
87.
Yeah. So the third.
And my is a bit different. I built like an urban map,
mm-hmm.
static.
Mm-hmm.
static
So
we built an unordered map and looked into it. The problem with doing that a static map is that these lambda can capture context. And it could be different on every call. And if you have a static object, then for the same call, it could actually look up the wrong function. That maybe even has a captured by reference and a local variable from a different iteration, from a different function call, which is gone by now. So,
I'm just trying to say, let's take this.
Yeah. OK, any more questions? OK, then. Thank you very much.